Hello and welcome to Newsclick's International Roundup. Today, we discuss recent developments in Venezuela and Syria. And to talk more about this, we have with us Prabir Purkayastha, Editor-in-Chief, Newsclick. Hello, Prabir. Prabir, let's start with Venezuela. As we know, yesterday evening, certain sections associated with opposition leader Juan Guaido, who is a self-proclaimed president, seized certain facilities in the United States, both in New York and Washington, belonging to the Venezuelan government. So they removed Maduro's portrait, replaced Guaido, and they have declared that in a few days they'll be seizing the Venezuelan embassy in Washington itself. So how do you see this recent development as part of a series of developments or a series of stages in which the US and various Western powers have tried to support Guaido and topple Maduro?
It's very clear that the regime change operation which started in Venezuela has actually failed in Venezuela. Even the attempt to have this Branson concert get starting with numbers like 400, 300, 200,000. They got barely 10 to 12,000 people over there. The most optimistic estimates being 20,000. Then this whole idea that they could march them into Venezuela and therefore the National Guards over there, the Venezuelan military police would not be able to stop them. All of that fell apart. We now have pictures which New York Times has accepted in its report, which it didn't initially, that this was actually the burning of the vehicles carrying some of this aid was set on fire by Guaido supporters. All of this seems to indicate that this whole regime change operation vis-a-vis Venezuela has at least very little internal support. And that's not surprising because Guaido, shall we say, was not the most well-known or popular person in Venezuela himself. So this has not been a surprise that he has not got any traction. So now there is a desperation of how does this regime change operation proceed. And the only way it can proceed is if the Lima group or the United States military intervenes in Venezuela. The Lima group more or less has said no. Though it is behind the regime change, but military steps, no. The United Nations has actually said that aid should not be militarized, that it should be neutral whenever such, if aid is being provided to a country which has, shall we say, civil turmoil. And United Nations has said we are interested in actually negotiations and rather than this kind of one-sided approach to the problem. So I think, given this, how does Guaido keep his momentum alive? He's not getting any traction in Venezuela. So the only option is taking the US help to try and seize some properties of the Venezuelan government, which would be against diplomatic rules of any kind, because the host state has to provide those, shall we say, protections to Venezuelan properties, embassies, in the United States. But again, the United States would say, oh, you know, it's an illegal government, Maduro's. Therefore, we are actually not protecting what is an illegal government's property. Therefore, this is okay. So these are the kind of things which international law is not being only stretched. It is actually broken severely. And I don't think this kind of things have happened earlier. We also have the recent case where the North Korean embassy was raided in Spain, and it was done by what was claimed to be North Korean shadowy organization which is fighting against the North Korean government, while the Spanish sources, government sources, say this appears to be a rogue CIA operation. So I think United States has decided it's a law unto itself. It always has. It has no respect for international law. And this attempts to seize property, shall we say, of the government of Venezuela, which the host countries are duty-bound under international law to protect, is being violated. It's really more of the same, shall we say.
And it also comes after say a couple of weeks after the massive cyber assault on the Guri hydroelectric plant, and which again Guaido and the US establishment sought to use as some sort of a staging board maybe for what they hoped would be massive protests. And of course, again, nothing of that sort happened. So this again reveals some sort of a particular desperation in terms of every single stage failing as of now.
Well, as you know, the US is the first country in the world which launched what would be called a military cyber attack when it attacked the centrifuges in the Natanz centrifuge plant in Iran. it was accepted that this was an act of war as defined in international law, because damage to property and human beings would qualify as a equivalent to a kinetic attack. Now, the Guri hydroelectric project, we don't have similar evidence that it was attacked in terms of which we have in Netherlands, but that takes time to come. So you need forensic evidence to be able to say what really happened. It's the possibilities are that it was a cyber attack, because the US has a history of doing it. And also there is documentation about that which Guaido and the groups which have supported him in the past, that the Gray Zone project, Max Blumenthal has a detailed piece on this, that one of the suppositions is that if electricity grid fails, then there could be a civilian protest and therefore civilian uprising. And one unfortunate problem in Venezuela, this really goes back to how the Venezuelans never foresaw all of this as a militarized issue, that they have one project which supplies, the Guri hydroelectric project we talked about, supplies Venezuela with 80% of its electricity. Therefore, there is a vulnerability of the electrical system over there. And therefore, taking down a centralized system which supplies 80% of the power of the electricity of the country is relatively, therefore, an easier target than if it had, for instance, five such plants in five different locations. So, of course, unless we said we have forensic evidence, we can't really talk about whether it's convincing evidence or not. But given what the United States is doing, given that the NSA and the CIA have really, shall we say, very high order of this kind of militarized cyber attacks, yes, I think it's not, it would not be surprising if it turned out that this was a cyber attack which led to the taking out of the stations. I don't expect it to last too long, that increasingly Venezuelans will be able to sanitize their system. And this is a single point of vulnerability, if they can protect that. And I think then there is only some, or there is only so much that the United States can do to cyber attacks. The question is that whether they will escalate it to a military attack. At the moment, signs seem to show, unless there is widespread, shall we say, unhappiness, demonstration, uprisings of different kinds in Venezuela, the United States and the Lima group don't think they can militarily intervene. So I think there is some ratcheting down of these kind of things, at least from other countries which had supported Guaido initially. I even start seeing now reports which indicate they're talking about President Maduro again. And this is, I think, a new one, because for about a couple of months, President Maduro was always addressed differently as one of the people, one of the presidents, or claiming to be presidents and so on, and who won in a fraud election, is something which always would be appended to his description. But I start seeing now a recognition that perhaps things haven't worked out the way that they thought they would when they supported Guaido.
And moving on to Syria, where the Syrian government has strongly responded against the US proposal to continue helping the White Helmets, the controversial group which has been associated with various controversies. So how do you see this move in the context of the recent developments in Syria, where on the one hand, of course, the ISIS is increasingly getting isolated, and on the other hand, there's been an increased discussions between Syria, Iran, Russia, even Turkey, to bring some sort of a final closure to the conflict?
Well, you know, the final closure of the conflict really depends on whether the United States will get out of Syria or not. And at the moment, it's saying that it's going to stay there. Okay, it's going to stay there because it wants to stabilize in some form the northern border with Turkey, which means, of course, the conflict with Turkey, and supporting to the Kurds. The Kurdish forces have to now decide which way they want to go. And I think increasingly the issue is that American support is really a long-term danger to the Kurds as well, because it means that you are depending on a country which can sacrifice you at will and which does not have any contiguous border with you. Well, you have your strong countries like Turkey, you have Iraq, you have Syria, which are your shall we say, neighbors, as well as Iran. So all of them, if they combine against Kurds, I don't think the Kurds really have too much of a option than to resist. So I think that's been the problem. We talked about the White Helmets. Well, White Helmets is a publicly known funded organization of both the United States as well as the British intelligence. In fact, originally it was set up by British intelligence a person who was virtually officially a part of the British military intelligence, and it has been funded openly by the British government as well as other NATO powers, including the United States. Therefore, it is a foreign funded organization which has acted as mouthpiece. Their main weapon has been the camera, and they have been in close, shall we say, partnership with the various insurgent groups over there and extremely rabid Islamist forces. And they are not Islamic forces, they're Islamist forces. That means they're really using Islam as a cover for a political agenda. My problem is, at the moment, the enclaves within which United States is still sitting, they're giving protection to this kind of forces, and they're also trying to maintain their long-term presence. Though Trump has announced that they're going to withdraw, at the moment on the ground, we don't see such moves. And therefore, it is something which will go to continue. The United States can act as a spoiler, but the United States has lost the plot in Syria. I don't think it has any chance of being able to destabilize Syria again. It can only prolong the conflict, and it can only play in the troubled waters. But I don't think it has the ability to do anything significant in Syria or even in Iraq anymore.
Thank you, Prabir. That's all we have time for today. Keep watching Newsclick.